Hello and welcome to The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. I'm Rocky Bakshi. In this show, we keep talking to leading personality each week. And this week, the guest with us is a Rajya Sabha MP, also very leading lawyer, Mr. KTS Tulsi. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you.
As we talk now, we know that the context is very relevant when we talk to you. The Supreme Court has just said that tainted politicians should not be included in the Council of Ministers and advice to Prime Minister and the Chief Ministers. How would you explain it all?
You see, who is tainted? After all, the Constitution gives you presumption of innocence till you are proven guilty. Our conviction rate is close to 6% of the number of persons against whom charge sheets, FIRs are filed. Half the cases are not sent to the court. What are sent to the court, barely 20%. So the conviction rate is less than 10%. Your political opponents can slap you with any number of cases. Overnight, the Chief Minister can engineer 100 FIRs against a particular person, which happened against Mr. Mulayam Singh when he was in opposition. So mere FIR can't make you tainted, in my opinion.
But don't you think this argument has been going on for a while, but still this kind of a verdict comes?
It's been going on. The question
so
is,
the need and timing of it.
Are we wanting to become a police state? What is an FIR? An FIR is an allegation thrown at you. Allegation can be thrown at, it can be true, it can be false. According to the law, an FIR has got to be registered. Now, the process in India is such a severe punishment. The truth or innocence, the innocence or guilt is not determined for 10 years, for 15 years. It's a lifetime.
Do you think there's some kind of ambiguity or some gray area which we need to really understand well?
Oh, the real problem in India, why we are grappling with so many issues, is delay in justice. If the courts are not going to decide cases for 10 years, what is going to happen to the individual? His life is gone. So to disqualify people only on the basis of an FIR or only on the basis of a charge sheet. Charge sheet, what is a charge sheet? Charge sheet is an opinion of a sub-inspector. Now, what is the charge? Which a framing of charge, they say, that is done by the court.
Don't you think the idea is to make politicians much more alert, maybe responsible, that they actually don't get nearer, closer to such a situation?
No, but motivated allegations will always be made. In India, if there are any number of, if the conviction rate is low, that means that so many cases are false. So what do? Charge is framed only on the basis of the allegation contained in the charge sheet. At that time, the accused is not even able to show that he is innocent. Because when the accused says that I am innocent, that's a matter of defense which has got to be proved after the prosecution evidence is over. Now that is going to take well over a year or two or five or ten.
You know, if you look at the timing and the journey that we all have had in terms of the constitution and how we have taken a journey from India's independence to now, and let's look at the politicians earlier, don't you think this is kind of trying to make a comment on the kind of politicians leaders we should have?
So long as the government of the day has complete grip over the police, you cannot clean the criminal justice system. Criminal justice system, you can't call people tainted because the police has registered an FIR, the police has filed a charge sheet, and the court on the basis of that charge sheet has framed a charge. No, the Constitution requires a conviction in accordance with law. No one can be punished except in the due course of law. The due course means a fair trial. A fair trial takes 15 years in
But the idea is that between a commoner and somebody who is influential or a politician would have more say, for example, if we compare the two situations, in terms of, I don't want to use the term, but managing the system somewhere.
Well, you see, people will have more say, no doubt, but then that is also a ground for filing false cases against them. The political opponents, if you give this power, if you say that a person against whom there is an FIR or a charge sheet or a charge has been framed should be deemed to be disqualified from holding a public office. If you have this, no opposition will ever win elections in this country. The government in power can successfully eliminate all the strong opponents.
By doing using it as a weapon.
If we take this too far, there are dangers to democracy. There are dangers to the rule of law. We can't make other people suffer for the inability of the justice system to deliver. We better fix the justice system. We can't find these shortcuts.
So you're trying to say, let's look at the root. But I mean, look at the phenomena of now, you know, the rising number of politicians getting fielded, for example, or getting tickets and finally getting into the cabinet, whether at the state level or
the central. Why is it happening? Because the judiciary is not deciding. Why is the judiciary not deciding? Because the government, in the current budget, there is a 0.4% allocation for justice, for law and justice. 0.4%.
Do you think budget is the only thing to be blamed for?
I mean, of course, if you are not going to provide facilities and if the courts are expected to run at bullock cart speed because the tools of technology, of the modern technology, are not being given, you can see the plight of a courtroom and compare it with the superintendent of police's office. The courtroom is so rudimentary. There are no facilities. We have to see the lowest court. We don't have to see the facilities in the Supreme Court.
You know, sorry to interrupt you here, but you know, we've been really looking at and listening to this for a very long time. We have been listening to all this and these kind of complaints coming in. But where have we moved? I mean, now there is some kind of restlessness.
I want to ask the Prime Minister, if justice is a priority, because the first obligation of the state is to give people protection of their life and property. If you can't do that, the state has no business to be there. And can you do this? Is this the fulfillment of the object by allocating 0.4% to judiciary? 0.4% is actually a recipe for disaster. From 15 years, we'll go to 20 years. The judiciary needs facilities. The judges need to work in today's environment and have the modern technology. We have to modernize the police station. There should be automatic recording of telephone lines. We have to, that will eliminate the political pressure that is brought to bear upon the
police. You're talking about the whole structure of judiciary and how this, that can be better, but we'll talk about it after a very short break. You are watching The Quest. We are talking to Mr. KTS Tulsi. Don't go away. We are still talking to him after this break. Welcome back to the show. We are talking to Mr. KTS Tulsi here. When we finished last before the break, we were talking about the whole structure that it should, how it should be reformed. So what are these things? I mean, we are talking about lack of courts. I mean, a lot of these structures that are missing. Would you like to say more on that?
I want to know that if there is a short circuit in your electricity and it goes off, the MCB goes off, and you say that, all right, I will fix a wire, a direct wire, and bypass the MCB. These bypasses are not going to help. We need to fix the system. Why are we not fixing the system? Shortcuts are going to make things worse. It's just not a solution. We need to ensure that all cases, and this is not difficult, you can bring criminal justice back on tracks by saying that there are, out of 1 crore 87 lakh, about 80 lakh cases are only traffic offences, which may be 10 years old, 15 years old.
You know, I'll just go back to the earlier thing, and when it is left to the wisdom of the Prime Minister, let's talk about the Prime Minister. And in fact, before the elections, I think in many interviews also, he came public and said that how he should be speeding up. I mean, all these cases, let's say, against parliamentarians should be speeded up and it should be leading to a cleaner system. That's the idea that he wanted to talk about.
You see, the society is so confused. And I'm sure so will be the Prime Minister. Who is guilty and who is innocent? When so many people against whom serious charges were thrown are honorably acquitted by the system, people don't know whether to love them or hate them. And this is an ideal recipe for the dishonest to thrive and the honest to suffer. We need to have a system in which we will deliver justice in a reasonable time, and according to me, reasonable time is not more than 6 months.
For example, since you've also, you know, been from Punjab and seen the situations there, we're talking about terrorism, and many of these cases, I'm reflecting on the system that when some of the Muslim youths are, you know, captured and they're interrogated, and many a time they're then found out that, you know, there was nothing wrong. So the kind of harassment one goes through. So would you like to talk about that as to, I mean, the same thing, that how people go through such things, a period of trauma, and after which they realize that nothing actually was there?
Well, there are cases. I was a special prosecutor prosecuting the terrorists in Punjab with the aid of TADA, and our conviction rate was a minuscule 1.4%. In spite of all the help that was provided by a special law to deal with terrorism, the judicial system is just not geared to function in an atmosphere of terror. So all that we could do with the biggest advantage of TADA was that we could retain somebody who has been arrested for 1 year instead of 90 days. But that does not substitute. Even the persons who surrendered to Mr. KPS Gill after holding up in the Golden Temple for more than 40 days, those persons surrendered with their weapons in their hands in front of the world media, and yet they were discharged, despite the fact that we had confessions which were recorded on video. The structure doesn't function.
Yeah, that's what you're coming.
In an atmosphere of terror.
That's you're coming back to. Let's talk about another important thing which happened, and since you are now in Rajya Sabha, this whole bill related to the judges' appointments and how the collegium was done away. I mean, how would you look at this whole background and then what led to it finally?
You see, I believe that independence of judiciary and the appointment system are two different things. There are many countries which have independent judiciary. We are proud of our judiciary. Our judiciary is second to none. In fact, in many of the cases, there are path-breaking tools that have been developed by the Indian judiciary. But nevertheless, there is not a single country where judges appoint judges. The appointment of judges cannot be, there is no institution where you can leave the employment of the next generation only to them. There are professional bodies for recruitment, and we must have a full-fledged secretariat like the UPSC, which will have a pool of eligible persons. They will be interviewed, there should be multidisciplinary consultation, there should be an opportunity given to the public to bring specific complaints against them and ask the nominees to defend themselves. And in America at least, this process happens publicly. The Senate of the Judicial Committee of the Senate invites the nominee and the objectors, and the objectors raise their objections, they file their objections in writing, bring their evidence, documents, witnesses, the nominee cross-examine them. And then the nominee brings their objections, and whatever is the decision is rendered in front of the media, in front of the public. Then only they are selected. It was said in America that no one would like to become a judge if he is going to be subjected to so much heat. And the answer to that the Americans give is that if you can't stand the heat, get out of kitchen.
Exactly. That's what, in fact, I would like to talk about. And then, you know, one famous case, of course, of an impeachment of a judge happened. But how would you look at now cleaning the system itself, since you are from judiciary?
Well, I'm so glad that the parliament has taken this step of some improvement, multidisciplinary consultation. I hope that it brings transparency. You see, the debate from 1990 to now has only been location of the power to appoint. That's irrelevant. That's a turf war. What's important is the process of appointment. According to me, the process must bring in transparency. The Supreme Court itself has prescribed transparency as a panacea to all ills of the executive. Every activity, every public activity is subjected to the gaze of transparency.
That's a very interesting point which I would like to really like you to elaborate upon, but right now we are taking another short break. You are watching The Quest. We are talking to Mr. KTS Tulsi. Don't go away. You're watching The Quest right now, and we are talking to Mr. KTS Tulsi. Sir, I remember once somebody mentioned this in Parliament itself, that how now court is giving verdict on everything. I mean, so this whole question about judiciary versus executive and legislative, there seems to be some kind of dominance, so to say, or why court has to talk about, let's say, the public utility system, how it's working? I mean, everyday affair, so to say.
Well, I do think that the judiciary, I wish judiciary would concentrate on adjudication. Adjudication we are not able to do. The backlog is increasing, maybe partly because it's at the expense of cases which are waiting. Half the time, if it is going to be taken in public interest, that is doing other people's work, your own work is getting neglected.
And why it's happening? I mean, that's what. I mean, there are politicians, there are ministries which are looking at their work. I mean, why you then see, you see all these...
Judiciary also realizes that it's virtually dealing with stale issues which the society has forgotten. If it were to concentrate only on adjudication, it will be deciding a murder case which happened 20 years ago. People have forgotten that. So, in order to stay relevant to what's happening, they would pick up ripe issues. There's so much injustice which is reported. And of course, the judges are tempted to deal with it.
How would you look at it? How would you?
I would say that the justification which is given, that there is the executive is not doing its job and therefore we are taking over.
Exactly.
It can be given by anybody. The executive can then say, since you are not doing your job, we are giving these cases to someone else, except that judiciary work cannot be given away to somebody, anyone else. It's basic structure.
But doesn't it talk about the system which sometimes gets a verdict from this supreme body, and that's how there is this alertness or pressure, so to say? I mean, isn't it sad actually?
It is sad. I think that the delay in system distorts justice. Nothing distorts it more than delay. And the judiciary must concentrate on clearing the backlog. Leave everything, clear the backlog. For heaven's sake, let's clear the backlog.
That's very important. Another thing which of course talks about women, and recently we saw, and you of course were also very vocal about it, the cleaning the judiciary itself as far as all these cases of harassment against women is concerned. So within judiciary, which is supposed to be a very holy body, all these fingers were pointed out.
That's true. I mean, judiciary in Vishakha prescribed the guidelines for the rest of the world. In India, for every institution, public or private, and when it comes to itself, there is a lady judge who is being harassed by a sitting judge. And she goes from pillar to post. There's no one who's willing to listen to her. In disgust, she resigns. What is the mechanism? Why is that mechanism not public, not transparent? Why can't we see what's happening? This lady's plight, in fact, should focus our attention to complete lack of institutional mechanism of dealing with complaints. Complaints not only are sexual harassments, complaints are corruption. The complainant must know how his complaint was dealt with.
Do you think there's more introspection and talk within the circle about how to really...
No, there is need to be much more, because we can't see it. If we can't see it, we won't be convinced. There may be some, but if we can't see it, how will we be convinced and how will we convince others? So the only thing that I could do was raise this issue in the Rajya Sabha. I raised this issue that how is it that the Chief Justice won't give her an appointment? And there is no hope left for thousands of female employees. This harassment takes place everywhere in the world, but there are systems by which it has to be dealt with. We can't go on protecting our own. If they have to dispense justice to the rest of the world, they must begin with themselves.
I think there's so many issues that we would really love to talk to you about, but summing it all up, how would you look at judiciary now really playing its role perfectly?
We are proud of judges, but I think our priorities are not right. And our first priority should be reducing the backlog. Till the backlog is reduced, the distortion in the rule of law is not going to end.
But it's a vast country. We are dealing with so many challenges, and you talked about some of the problems that we have already. How do you think there is a road ahead on which one walks?
No, I think that judiciary is only firefighting. There is no system, there is no scheme by which we are going to deal with the backlog.
And talking about the context that from where we began is this whole cleaning the whole system and a fairer system where people with much more credibility and cleaner background come in. How do you think? Do you think there is a sense of direction which is right?
There is a sense of direction. This is extremely desirable. This is exactly what should happen, that people who are tainted should not be inducted in public offices. A civil servant against whom there is a case cannot be appointed to a civil post. How is it that a minister can be appointed? And how much of moral authority will he wield over the department, the officers and the general public? But who is responsible? We are also responsible. Judiciary is responsible.
So there should be wider debate and exchange of thoughts. Do you think that it should lead to that at least?
Yes, it should lead to that. Mm-hmm. I hope so. And the judiciary also need to interact more with the public.
That's a very valid point, that it should be connecting more to the realities.
Yes, people want to know, people have a vital interest in justice, and they want to get justice. If they don't, then after all, what is justice? A civilized alternative to fighting on the streets.
Yeah. One thing on a little personal and lighter note also, you've been a leading lawyer now in Rajya Sabha. So judiciary getting into political system very actively, how do you look at it?
I don't think I'm political because I have the honor of being nominated, and I don't have to depend on any political party. But I think that lawyers have played a vital role throughout in public life, political or apolitical. Lawyers can contribute a great deal, although I think the percentage of lawyer MPs has gone down a little.
Okay, so you would like it much more, but thank you so much for spending your time and talking to us on Rajya Sabha TV. It was a pleasure talking to you. And that was Mr. KTS Tulsi. We talked to him on all the relevant issues. Hope you like this particular edition of The Quest. Keep watching. Namaskar and bye-bye.